Now one of America's funniest comedians, Steven Wright, who combines his surreal thought process and a trademark deadpan delivery to offer us his own unique perspective on the world around us. Thank you for joining us and welcome
to
CBS.
Thank you for having me. Thank you very much.
Your your pace is so different from that employed by any other comedian or performer on television. You almost dare us to click waiting for the punchline. How did this develop?
It just was just the way I speak. You know, when I started, I was nervous and I spoke really fast. And then the more relaxed I got, I just started talking like I normally speak, and it was just happened. It's kind of an illusion, though, because I tell a lot of jokes in a short time.
Right.
But my tone of voice makes it seem like it's slower than it is.
Was there a time, though?
Do you think I'm talking to you slower now?
No, you're talking more rapidly now than you were 2 minutes ago. But what I'm interested here is, when you're out and about in your normal life, do you use more inflection than you do in your stage delivery?
No. I use more when I talk to people I know. So when I'm out and about with, like, hanging out, if I don't know the people, it's the same as on stage, because the audience is strangers. But if I'm with my friends, then it can be more like, you know, as much as Charo.
Are you ever afraid, with your measured delivery, that at the end of the joke, there will not be a laugh?
Oh, that happens all, when I try material out, that happens all the time. Most material doesn't work. So when I'm testing it out, most of it doesn't work. Right. So I experience that all the time.
And in watching you, Stephen, I noticed that you don't go after big topics. You don't do big name politicians. You don't do much O.J. Simpson. You don't do a lot of major, you do little things in life that madden us all.
Yeah,
the kind of stuff I refer to as the saran wrap not coming off the roll and the
right.
Band-Aid string that doesn't open the package, that sort of thing.
Yeah, I like talking about basic things like time and space and lint and and maps and signs, and the giant stuff is just, for humor, it interests me in real life, but for humor it doesn't interest me. I like talking about the little things that everyone deals with, the little tiny things that aren't really discussed. That's what, I don't know why that interests me, but it does.
But how do you notice these things? Not a lot of people would think, for example, of a very funny word you just said, which is lint. Lint's a, you know, nobody, lint's in the dryer.
Lint is a big part of our lives, but it's never discussed. Why do I notice it? I don't know. It's just, a comedian is like a sociologist. You're just looking at everything. And when I was a kid, I did a lot of painting and drawing. So that helped me really notice, because when you draw something, you're going to really zero in to mimic it, you know, just, so then that helps me with the comedy, because that's what you're doing. You're just looking at the world. That's
now,
all you're doing is looking at the world.
You draw the parallel to art and comedy, painting and comedy. I read a story about you where you went through an art museum as a young boy, 15-year-old boy, 16-year-old boy, and you were fascinated by a painting in this gallery, but the teacher rushed you along. She didn't allow you to question the importance.
Oh, right. Yeah. We went on a field trip to Boston. I grew up outside of Boston. We went into Boston, and there was a surrealistic exhibit. And I had never seen surrealism before, mm-hmm. and I was immediately taken by it. You know, like a clothespin the size of a silo, or a road that comes down into a waterfall. And I was like, this is the greatest stuff that I've ever seen. But the teacher wasn't into it, so she kind of like, you know, sidetracked me for a while. But it never left my head, and it's still the favorite art that I have is surrealism. And then years later, when I started writing comedy, I think that it definitely affected, because my stuff is kind of
surrealistic
with words, though.
And had you ever thought about being a painter, being an artist?
Yes, I did. I thought I would go to art school. I thought that's what I would do. But then I thought they would ruin me, because I wanted to paint just insane weird stuff, and I would end up doing, like, stuff for catalogs. I'd be drawing a toaster for the catalog, you know, like, so I thought, I said, I'm not going to do that, because I know they won't, I won't be able to do what I really want to do. So I just blew it off.
And then what drew you to comedy?
The Tonight Show.
Johnny Carson.
Watching it every single night with my older brother, and watching Johnny and loving Johnny doing his monologue and dealing with the guests, and watching, like, Pryor come on, and George Carlin, and Robert Klein, and David Brenner, and all these guys, and it was like, Jesus, that would be really something. That's what I would want to do.
The Tonight Show, or to be a guest on the program and do comedy?
To be a guest, to be a stand-up comedian,
right,
and do
right
an appearance on the show.
Yeah, and like, you would watch it with your older brother every night. Was this when, in the 60s, 70s?
It was in the late 60s, all the way, like, till he went off.
Mm-hmm. And did you have an insatiable desire from watching all these programs to personally shake hands with Ed McMahon?
No. Ed's a nice guy.
He's a great guy. One of the greatest.
You're projecting your own fantasy.
Yes, you are correct.
Back with the amazing mind of Steven Wright and a couple of you guys on the toll-free at 800-952-2788 after these messages. God, get off of me.
I'm sorry.
Go ahead, Misty. It's Tom. How are you?
I'm fine. How are you?
I'm fine, thank you.
Steven, I was just wondering, well, first I'd like to say that I'm a big fan. I've watched you for many years, and I think you're wonderful.
Thank you.
And I was just wondering that
what
why you don't...
What
if she's talking
to me?
I beg
your pardon? Steven.
Oh, okay.
That's how I knew it was me.
Oh. Okay, I was wondering why you do not have your own sitcom when so many other comics now do.
I've been sidetracked. I've been on the road, and I'm not ready to see if I can get my perspective into a half hour every week at this point. I don't know if I could do it every week, so I've just remained doing stand-up.
Okay. Well, can I ask another question?
Of course you can.
Will you come to Fort Smith, Arkansas?
Yes, I will. I should be there earlier tomorrow morning.
Great.
No, someday, maybe I'll be there, yeah.
Hey, Misty, it's another stay up all night Friday waiting for Steve to get to town.
That's right.
Thanks for watching, and thank you for calling.
Thank you.
All right,
bye.
Bye-bye. Bye, Bonds. In college, you worked on the radio station, and you expected to have a lot of freedom there and found out you were doing what other people wanted you to do and not what you wanted to do.
I was shocked. I studied radio in school, and by the time I finished, I hated it. I thought a guy went into a room and was insane and did whatever he wanted. And then I learned, you know, PSA, do this, play this song, do this at this exact time. It was like being in Audio San Quentin.
So how do they let you know you have to do what the format says and not what you want to do?
It was just laid out. It was just like they explained how it worked.
Well, I understand, but then you didn't go in there and do, for example, what Robin Williams did so effectively as Adrian Cronauer in Good Morning Vietnam, as a freewheeling disc jockey who did what he wanted. You didn't do that sort of thing, and they came and said, by the way, Steven, you can't do this.
No,
you walked in, saw the format, and said, oh, this is what I got to do.
Yeah, I was not rebellious at that time, and
right,
I just did what they wanted me to do, and it was very boring.
And you didn't do it very long?
No, I just did it at college.
College.
I didn't even pursue it. By the time I left school, I knew I didn't even want to try to...
You know, it's really a shame because, you know, radio at its unfettered best is a wonderful medium in which to work. The chat programs, the talk shows, for example, are wonderful vehicles for people who have things to say and wish to say them, because there is no format. Like here, you know, we pretty much do what we want to do here within reason, and we don't have to do the PSAs all the time.
But radio then, like in 76,
right,
7, when I was in college, was more like music. It wasn't like, I wasn't thinking talk radio, you know, I was thinking, I thought the guy could do whatever he wanted and play whatever music he wanted.
Yeah.
And then, but now it would be different if you did a talk show.
Colin on the toll-free in North Gower, Ontario. Hello.
Hello there. Hi.
Good evening, Colin. How are you?
Just fine. It's Colin. Yeah.
Colin, I'm sorry.
No problem. So, Stephen, I'm just curious. How do you feel when you hear people delivering comedy when they imitate your style, or if you hear someone in a bar delivering like you?
Oh, it's all right. You know, I don't know. It's amusing, I guess. It doesn't bother me at all.
Imitation being the sincerest form of thievery.
It's just that you're so unique, I thought that might really bother you.
No, it bothered me like when it first started happening, and then I realized, well, what am I going to do? I can't go change it, so it doesn't, you know, as I got older, my priorities changed, and like someone doing that, it doesn't matter anymore.
Colin, how did you discover Stephen's work?
Well, I think Dr. Demento played some of it a long time ago.
All right. Yeah. Is he still on the air, Demento?
I don't think so.
We ought to get him on here. He's a nifty guy.
Yeah, he certainly had a good perspective on a lot of different weird stuff.
Hey, demented discs.
Yeah, absolutely. So, thanks very much.
Thank you for calling, Colin. Have a nice weekend now.
You too.
And then there were the years you spent parking and painting.
Parking cars, yes. Parking cars, painting apartments, painting schools. I parked cars in Boston and for a restaurant that had no parking lot. Where you would get the car, get in it, and drive around and look for a space. And then you'd come back and write down on the ticket with the keys and put it on the board where it was parked in the area. And did this all night, and then people would come out at the end of the night, and once in a while some drunk guy would knock over the board and the ticket would come off the key. And then 20 people would come out at once because the place is closed, and where's my white Mustang? And you're going, oh, I think it's on Boylston Street. Oh, man. So you'd be running up and down the street trying to find cars and putting keys in that don't fit. Yeah. Then I parked cars for Harris in
Lake Tahoe?
No, in Reno. I lived in Reno for a few months after college, and I parked cars for Harris. And, you know.
Same thing, yeah, parked cars, yeah. You do a lot of traveling in your job.
Yes, I do.
A lot of flying, and I'm told you're not crazy about it. Not crazy about ordering a Coke at 20,000 feet.
No, it's completely weird to me to be going 500 miles an hour asking someone to bring you another Coke. 5 miles in the air. I don't like it. I like doing the shows, but I don't like getting from point A to point B.
It's amazing the insanity we accept as reality in our lives, isn't it?
Absolutely. Yeah.
I wish you great success. Thanks for coming
on. Thank you. Thanks for
having me. We're big fans here, and we appreciate you joining us, Stephen.
Thank you.
Stephen Wright, folks. Coming up, the lady who invented margaritas. In fact, you're welcome to stay and help us celebrate Cinco de Mayo.
Okay.
Can hardly get it out with the anticipation of it all. And there is a picture of Ed McMahon waiting for you outside. Next up, Margarita, inventor of the drink that bears her name, after these messages. Next guest forever changed the world of cocktails about 46 years ago when she mixed up a few favorite ingredients and created the drink that still bears her name. I'm very pleased to welcome here on Cinco de Mayo, Margarita Sames. Thanks for coming on. Welcome to our little bar here.
Thanks for having me.
Now, I read that you began your day today in San Antonio, Texas, by pouring the first bottle of Cointreau into what would become the world's first 3,500-gallon margarita.
Yes, sir.
why would they make a 3,500-gallon margarita?
Well, I can be very honest with you. I don't know.
Very good. I appreciate that honesty.
I don't know.
How did you invent this drink?
Well, I can tell you that. I do know. I really know, and I'm going to be very happy to make one for you.
Right. Would you like to make it as you tell it? Would that be okay,
let
fine. Well, why don't you stand up behind the bar, and I'll just sit here and watch the magic happen, as I do here so many nights.
Now, we know I can go.
Yeah, now don't fall off the chair, or it's curtains.
We have already rehearsed that a little bit.
Okay.
So there.
Mm-hmm.
I'm tangled up in something. Okay.
Okay. You okay now?
Okay.
All right, good.
All right.
Ladies and gentlemen, here she is, the one, the only, Margarita Sames.
Okay. Now we're going to move this right here. Oh, I need something to mix in.
Oh, like a cocktail. Well, you see.
I need this to mix in.
Oh, you need this to mix in.
Yeah.
All right. So let me get this out of here.
Yeah.
Okay. Just give me anything.
Just get me a small amount of this.
Just give me a coffee can.
Yeah.
Whatever we got back there.
Yeah.
Pour the gin out of the bottle. Bring the bottle. It'll be fine. Yeah. Whatever.
I'm sorry.
Mm-hmm. We need this, right?
Yeah. No, we need some of it. We need.
All right. While they're getting that, tell the story then of how the margarita was invented.
All right. I will tell you.
Yeah. Wait. Let me get this fly away from the back of your head. There we go. Perfect. Okay. Yeah. Now, can you mix in that?
Yes.
I'm not convinced. Let me get this stuff out of here.
Yeah, this will be better.
Okay, good.
And just leave some of that here. That's enough.
Like that?
No, leave that container here. Because I'm using a jigger of that lime juice, see? I use a jigger in each recipe. That's perfect.
Yes, sir. Okay.
All right, now we're going to go.
So you were sitting around the pool one afternoon, and you decided, let me put these items together.
Well, it's more or less like that, I'm telling you. As a matter of fact, I had... it all started in Acapulco, and... this is a slow thing, isn't it? That's the way we do in Texas with our hats. That's perfect. See, let's get this on the road. All right.
All right, now that's a little Cointreau, right?
Yep. Just
get off me while I lean down to pick up this ice cream.
Yeah. Okay.
I know it's off the floor. The booze will kill it.
Jose Cuervo is very fine.
All right, so what'd you pour in there?
I haven't poured anything yet. I'm just getting ready, mister. And I'm going to do it.
This would be a jigger of...
Well, as a matter of fact, yes. We're going to do a jigger of this. One.
That's Cointreau, right?
Yes.
Okay.
And it's very fine. And that's what makes the margarita. Now we're going to do three of these.
And that would be tequila.
Yes.
Uh-huh.
And this is a very good...
Fill them up nice and full now, margarita.
Okay, I did cheat a little.
We want our full share.
Okay.
And if we're going, let's go all the way.
Now this is going to be three...
Somebody call the Beverly Hills Police, please.
Now, look, this can be cut to two, but I like it this way. And this is the way I make it.
All right, so then it's three tequila to one Cointreau.
And one jugo limon. Now, how am I going to get that poured into this?
Get what poured into what, honey?
This lemon juice. I mean, lime.
Where is the lime juice?
Here it is.
Oh.
Let me see. I can do it. But you don't want too much.
No.
One jigger. And some people have...
All right, so it's three jiggers of tequila, one jigger of Cointreau, and one jigger of lime juice.
Mm-hmm. And...
Three...
One.
Yeah, I understand that. I'm just trying to tell the folks who are out there writing this down with a pencil and a paper. You know, they stay up till 2 in the morning to write stuff down that I tell them. It's a little... we're going to get a decoder ring like Captain Midnight used to have. I'll just give letters out and I'll decode. Yeah. They drink lots of margaritas.
Now you just...
Then you mix it up, right?
And you stir. And you stir. One of you have, bigger ice, but
yeah.
It's...
You know what's amazing, margarita, is that... Oh, by the way, who named this drink? Did you name it for yourself?
No, as a matter of fact, let me tell you, we had... for over 2 years, we called it the drink. It had no name.
Yeah, the drink that had no name. I know that one well, yeah.
Well, and I'm telling you, the only place you could get the drink was at our house.
Uh-huh.
So our friends kind of like that.
I'm sure they did.
And then...
Why don't you pour it now, see what happens?
I'm going to still have something else to do.
Okay.
I'm going to have to do the glass, see?
We have 1 minute now.
1 minute.
All right, you rub that with lime, right?
Yes. Like that.
Can I ask you a question?
Of course.
And I'm not trying to be a smartass.
Okay, don't do that. But ask me anything.
Have you had any margaritas today?
No, I haven't.
Okay.
I see that's too much salt.
We'll live with it.
Well, yeah, but it's too much.
I know it is, but we're going to live with
it. But you see, I need a flat paper towel, and you would just put it down and then lift it right up.
But I'll tell you, purposes of TV, you have no idea what a giant this is.
And you pour.
Then you pour, and then you drink. Is that right?
And then you drink.
Back with a taste of the margarita from the woman who invented it, Margarita Sames, after these messages. Margarita, thanks for being with us today. Los Angeles, you can't see this. President Clinton denounces militant militias as false patriots. Lead story right there, tomorrow morning's Los Angeles Times. My thanks to Margarita for being here, and out of courtesy, I must taste this concoction. This would be three of the tequilas, one of the Cointreaus, one of the lime juice, and some of the salt, right? Boy, that's salty. By the way, she said, now I'm going to drool my way through the clothes here. Tom, it's not important. Next week, Robert McNamara, Martin Mull, Pete Rose, and Merv Griffin. Have a wonderful, wonderful weekend. Back Monday night, same time, same station. Thanks for watching, everybody. That frozen can-